Welcome back. We're still in the process of analyzing periodic discrete systems. In the previous video, when we were talking about discrete periodic systems, we investigated the behavior of a spring mass system. Identical masses are repeated, connected with identical springs, and we saw that there appeared to be something like what we claim to be the stop band, but it doesn't really show anything new. We already knew that. We already understand this very well. When the frequencies are quite high, the response of the system decays quickly. Now we are going to try to investigate another system that's still a discrete system, but with alternating masses. In this case, we have the masses changing. One is 2m, and one after it is m, 2m, m, 2m, m, and so on. Now we select the cell to start at one of the 2m's and end in the following one. So we know the cell has two springs in it and three masses. Although the three masses have the same values, now this is a part of a periodic structure. This thing should be repeating forever, ideally. And then we will see, like we did last time, what happens if we just use few cells. How will those few cells be behaving as we excite them harmonically? So the first step is obtain the natural equations of motions, introduce harmonic excitations, so the relation becomes an algebraic relation between the amplitude of excitation and the amplitude of the response. But in our case here, we have 3 degrees of freedom, x1, x2, and x3. Note that x2 is in the middle of the cell. There is no force that we are interested in here. Remember, we are interested in the force and displacement of the input side and force and displacement of the output side. All other forces inside the cell are in internal equilibrium, so we are not really interested in them. That's why we can eliminate this equation by moving x2 to one side and writing it in terms of x1 and x3. Now, this is readily available. Use this relation into the first equation and the third equation to eliminate x2. This is very well known as reduction, dynamic reduction, based on another way earlier known as static reduction. In this process, we didn't lose any of the generality. It's not here that I'm going to explain how we are not losing any of the generality, but just take my word for that. These two equations contain all the information that was already in the original 3 equations. Okay, now we have input x1 f1, output x3 f3. Let's rearrange the equations to obtain them on one side to get the transfer matrix, then introduce the exponential relation between the input and the output to obtain finally the equations in the form that we had before in the discrete or the general problem. Now we need to get the eigenvalues of this relation. So what we will get here is the determinant that gives us the characteristic equation, and again we have a very simple, nice looking characteristic equation that is parabolic in lambda. We can solve it right away to get the values of lambda using this relation. Okay, so we followed the same steps. Okay, let me be clear here. We followed the same steps. First, we introduced them in a general problem. Last video we introduced them for identical mass spring systems. Now we introduce them, now we are introducing them to alternating masses in a spring mass system as well. When we are focusing on the cell, we were able to reduce the equations. Instead of having 3 degrees of freedom or 3 equations, we reduced them readily without losing any generality. We obtained 2 equations and then rearranged the 2 equations to get the input-output relation, the transfer matrix, which was then rearranged to obtain the eigenvalue problem. Okay, back to our presentation. As we got the relations for lambda here, again we are interested in what's under the root. Whether it's a positive or a negative number. When it's a positive number, we get stop bands. When it's a negative number, we get pass bands with complex values. So here, for the pass bands, I'll just talk about the pass bands here. I need this square bracket to be less than 1. For this square bracket to be less than 1, I can easily find the relations here that it's either greater than minus 1 or less than 1. Moving the terms around and simplifying, we get that it's either, this is either greater than 0 or less than 2, which is actually presenting an inequality involving a parabola. To get that, we need those 3 conditions to be true. The omega squared m over k, again, the most important term we get always, omega squared m over k, is between 0 and 3, as 2 positive numbers. And we have 2 other conditions. Omega squared m over k has to be less than 1, and omega squared m over k has to be greater than 2, which actually gives us 2 regions that satisfy the original inequality. Those 2 regions are from 0 to 1 and from 2 to 3. So what did we have here? Remember, we are focusing on the pass bands. So now we see that we got 2 pass bands. One is from 0 to 1. The omega squared m over k can have the values from 0 to 1, and the other band is from 2 to 3. Okay, let's see. Let's use the same program we had last time, but now modify it for a 3 degree of freedom problem and see what happens. Here you get the eigenvalues. Again, we started from 1, moved, this is a complex conjugate. The real part changed from 1 to minus 1. As soon as it reached minus 1, 2 real eigenvalues appeared. One of them is equal to 1 over the other. So you can imagine that at this point, for example, which is about 1.25, something like that, this is 2 and this is 1 half, or minus 2 and minus 1 half. Then they got back together here at square root of 2. Remember, we had a pass band from 0 to 1 and another one from 2 to 3. So here we get square root of 2, and they continue as a complex conjugate until the square root of 3, which is almost 1.7. Then again, they separate into 2 real values, but now they are separated forever. They will continue, this one will continue growing, and this one will continue decaying until any value, for any larger value of omega. Okay, so if these are the eigenvalues, this is how the eigenvalues change with the frequency. Let's see how the propagation coefficient or the propagation factor is changing. Here you are. From 0 to 1, we are having the imaginary part only, while the real part is 0. The imaginary part grows from 0 to pi. And then as the frequency reaches 1, it plateaus, the imaginary part stops changing, it stops at the value of pi, while we get a real value that's growing until almost 1.25. Then it decays again to get back to zero, so the real value appears between 1 and square root of 2. During that band, that stop band, the imaginary part is constant at the value of pi. As soon as the imaginary the real part becomes equal to zero, the propagation coefficient again turns to be pure imaginary, changing from pi to zero. Now, as it reaches the value of zero, changes the imaginary part again, stops, plateaus at the value of zero, while the real part starts growing, and for this case it will grow forever. So we have this, we may call this side a stop band, but here is the real stop band that we are looking for, this blob disappearing in the middle of the graph. Let's see now what happens for the frequency response of a single cell. Well, okay, from 1 to square root of 3, there or square root of 2, there's something here, okay, but nothing really clear. Now, if we connect 4 of these cells, we can see something different. Now, you can see very clearly that between 1, almost, and square root of 2, also, there is no natural frequency appearing in the frequency response. Here you are, 3 natural frequencies, 4 actually here, and 3 others, so because I used 4 cells, 7 masses. In this band, which corresponds to the stop band we already obtained here, okay? At this band, the frequency response is extremely low. Remember, this is a logarithmic scale. So actually, this is dropping extremely small. Of course, again, at very high frequencies, the drop is more rapid. But again, this is not something special for the periodic structures. But what's special for a periodic structure is this drop that we have here corresponding to the stop band we obtained in our periodic analysis. Okay, now in the next video we'll start talking about periodic bars, but now let's just quickly summarize what we have seen in this video. In this video, we used, again, spring mass systems connected together. But in our case, this time, the masses changed. So we have a big mass, a small mass, a big mass, small mass, big mass, small, and so on. When we analyzed the cell, it was a 3-degree of freedom cell. And that 3-degree of freedom cell, when we obtained its propagation factor, we found that there is a blob. This blob appearing in a band of frequencies somewhere in the middle. Okay, this stop band should indicate that there is a decay in the vibration. This decay in vibration, which we call stop band, is what characterizes periodic structures. When we go in the coming video and start analyzing periodic bars or later periodic beams and much later periodic plates, these stop bands are actually what we are looking for. Even if we are designing a problem, the design problem, by the way, is quite hard. If we design a problem, we target a band of frequencies during which the frequency response of our system will be quite low. That's what we are talking about here. So I hope that the idea of periodic structures is clearer now as we introduce the alternating masses. We are going to use the same procedure to go on and handle a periodic structure, the first case will be a periodic bar, then we will talk about periodic beams. We will see what's happening with these structures when we introduce periodicity in them, and how we get the stop bands, and maybe even how we can design for a certain stop band. So I hope you continue with us these lectures about periodic structures, and that for any time, if you have any question, please don't hesitate to contact me through YouTube or through the website of the Academy of Knowledge. You can also download the lecture notes from ResearchGate. You can download the slides of these lectures from Academy of Knowledge. All these links are available to you in the text below the video. If you are watching it on YouTube, if you are watching it on the Academy of Knowledge, then everything will be there as well. So see you next time to talk about periodic bars.